Hello and welcome to STQV Foundation Level Syllabus. We are continuing with chapter number 1, that is Fundamentals of Testing based on Indian Testing Board. Until now we covered what is testing. In that we saw the typical objectives of testing, and then we covered the difference between testing and debugging. Now we are going to cover the next topic, that is the second topic. Why is testing necessary? Under this, we have four subtopics. First, we have to see why is testing necessary with the help of an example. Then we have to describe the relationship between testing and quality assurance and give example of how testing contribute to the higher quality. This is what we have to see. Then we have to differentiate between error, defect and failure. This is very important. So you need to know what is the meaning of error, what is the meaning of defect, and what is the meaning of failure after this topic. And at the end, we have to differentiate between root cause and the effect. So what is effect, we should know, and what is the root cause of that, that also we should know. So these are the four topics which we are going to cover in this lecture. Let's start with the first one, that is, why is testing necessary? So first of all, we know that being human, we can make mistakes. So we are human, and as a human, we can make mistakes. But sometimes these mistakes can be very expensive. We already saw it may result in loss of money, loss of time, loss of reputation, and in extreme cases, injury or death. So this is what we need to remember. Being human, if we make mistake, that means we create a faulty software, and a faulty software may result in these issues. So what we should do, that is why we have to test each and everything we produce. Whatever is our output in the software development lifecycle model, we have to test them. So this is one reason why we have to perform testing, because being a human being, we may make mistake. And there are a few more factors which we need to see. So one part we have answered why the testing is necessary. Now let's see it in more detail. First factor is risk. To reduce the risk associated with the product. So we perform testing so that we can reduce the risk which is associated with the product. What is the risk? That the product may fail when the user is using it. So we want to reduce such type of risks. Detect defect, that means we perform testing to detect defects so that they are not seen in operational use. Operational use means when the user is using the product or the customer is using the product, that is the operational use. So we don't want to see defect during that time or those times, and that is the reason we perform testing, so that we can detect the defect. And the last one is to meet the contract. So we perform testing to make sure that what we committed, we are meeting. So initially, before we start the project, we make the contract with the customer. And during testing, we see that whatever we committed to the customer, whether we are fulfilling that or not. So these are the three points or factors why we perform testing. First one is based on risk. We want to reduce the risk. We want to detect the defect, and we want to see that we are fulfilling the contract or not, contractual requirement or not. Now let's see an example to understand why testing is necessary or why it is required. Suppose there is a developer. Okay, the developer develops the code, and then what he does is he delivers that code to the customer. Now after receiving this code or the software, the customer is unhappy. Why the customer is unhappy? Because the customer found bug in the developed software. Now the question is, why customer found this bug? If you remember this diagram, we had the software, and what we did in this scenario is that once the software was developed, it was directly given to the user without sending it through this process, and this process is called testing. The software was not tested. It was directly given to the user. And that is the reason why user found this defect instead of tester in the testing environment. So what is necessary here then? The point which I want to make is we have to perform appropriate testing at appropriate levels. At different level, we need different type of testing, and that type of testing we should perform at that level. This line is very important. Appropriate testing at appropriate levels. Let's see what are the different levels. The first level is the requirement level. This is the level where we get the requirement or where we deliver the requirement in the requirement stage. The next stage is the design stage. Okay, and after that comes the coding stage where we code, where we develop the code one by one or module by module, and then comes the software. So these are the different levels, and at each level we have to perform different type of testing which is suitable for that level. That is important. Okay, for example, when we are at the requirement level, the code is not available, then we cannot perform dynamic testing over here. We have to perform static testing. That is what we have to do. Similarly, in the design stage, we cannot perform dynamic testing because the code is not available. So we have to perform static testing. That is appropriate for that level, this level. When you are developing the code, you develop code module by module, component by component, unit by unit. So once one unit or one module or one component is ready, you have to perform component testing on it. Whereas if you have the complete software, then you will perform verification and validation on it. So what we can see here is that we perform different type of testing at different level. And if we do that, then only we will reach our target. Then only the product will succeed. We will cover this point in more detail in the next slide or in the upcoming slide. But before that, let's summarize what we have covered till now. First, we saw why is testing necessary. Testing is done to reduce the risk, to find defects, and to verify contract fulfillment. And the important point over here is one need to perform appropriate testing at appropriate levels. This is very important. Now we will explore this point in more detail. The last one, appropriate testing at appropriate levels. So now what we are going to see is we are going to give an example of why testing is necessary. And with this we will see how testing contributes to the success. So we are performing testing at different levels. We are performing testing at requirement level, design level, coding level, software level. So how performing testing or how performing appropriate testing at appropriate level contributes to the success? That is what we have to see now. So this is the first topic which we are going to cover. So we already saw these are the different levels. One is the requirement level, design level, coding level, and software level. And if we perform appropriate testing at appropriate level, then only we will succeed. This is what we covered. Now we will see each of these level one by one. First is the requirement level. When you are at the requirement level, you can only perform review. Review is of type static testing. What I mean over here is, until you implement the code, you cannot execute your code. That means you cannot perform dynamic testing. What you can perform is static testing. So when you are at the requirement level or when you are at the design level, you can only perform static testing. Whereas when you are at the implementation level, you can perform two types of testing, static as well as dynamic testing, because now the code is available or the code is partially available. So now why we do this review? We review the document to detect defect in these work products. We perform review so that we can find the defects. If we find defect, what will happen? If we find defect, we reduce the risk of incorrect or untestable functionality being developed. What it means is, if you find the defect at the requirement level itself, then you can avoid fault multiplication. The fault will not reach until here, not until the implementation level. If something which you cannot test is available here, when you perform the review, you can remove them. And then it will not reach to the implementation level, and then people can implement what that they have to implement. Okay. And if you do that, then you will, that will contribute to the success factor. So you have the requirement, you can only perform review on it. When you perform review, you detect the defect. If you detect the defect, you reduce the risk. And finally, that will help in achieving the success. Similar to the requirement level, we have the design level. We have a system design. At this level, we perform review so that it increases each party's understanding, because everyone is involved in the review activity. They will discuss, they will decide something, there will be some open points. People will have different opinions, but in the meeting that will be addressed, and by doing that, they will increase the each party's understanding. And if we do that, then finally what will happen? We will reduce the risk of fundamental design defect. So if you are at the design level, if you find the defects, then what you are doing, you are reducing the defects to pass to the different level, to the next level. Okay. And if you do that, then it will contribute to the success factor. So this is all about the design level. When you are at the coding level, so here what you do is you develop the code, right? Then again you increase each party's understanding of the code, because you are calling for the review. And during review, all the required stakeholders will be involved in it. And when they are there, when the understanding increases, finally it will help in reducing the risk of the defect within the code. If there are some defects in the code, we can reduce it. Let's see an example to understand this. Suppose this is the customer requirement, where we have to check window moves up within 10 milliseconds once the button is pressed. So what they are saying, once we press the button, within 10 milliseconds the window shall move up. But the developer has written code like this. So this is a function for up movement, and here we have a condition where the developer is looking for the timer, and he is checking if the timer is pressed for less than or equal to 10 milliseconds, less than and equal to. That means at 10 milliseconds also the window is not moving up, right? So it should be less than. So when the timer expires, when it is more than that, then only the window shall move up. So this type of defect we can find when we are at the coding level by performing review on it. And if we find such type of defects, then we will contribute to the success factor of the project. Next one. Sorry. Software. So when you are at the software level, what you can do is you can verify and validate the software. Why are you doing verification and validation? So that you can detect the failures that might otherwise have been missed. So if you don't perform this, if you don't perform testing at this level, there is a possibility that you may miss some defects. And that is what you want to find here. And if you find the defect, what will happen? Finally, you will remove the defects that cause the failure. So whatever problems you will see, that will be fixed. And if that is fixed, what will happen? Then you will meet the stakeholders' need. And if the stakeholders' need is met, then the stakeholder or the customer will be happy. So these are the different levels which we see, and we saw that how performing testing at different level contributes to the success. Okay. So this is all about why testing is necessary, and we also saw the different examples. Now what we need to see is some quizzes based on the topic. So the first question is straightforward. Why is testing necessary? So the first option is because testing is a good method to make there are no defect in the software. Okay, what they're saying is if we perform testing, then we can say that there are no defect in the software. I told before also that this is a completely wrong statement. We are performing testing to find the defect, but if we are not finding the defect, that does not mean that in the software there is no defect. Okay, A. Point number B. Because verification and validation are not enough to get to know the quality of the software. Verification and validation are part of testing. So they will definitely contribute to the quality of the software. So this option is also wrong. C. Because testing measures the quality of the software system and helps to increase the quality. This is right. Right? We perform testing so that we measure the quality, and if we see that there are some bugs, then what we can do? We can fix them, and by fixing that, we increase the quality of the software. Last option, because testing finds more defect than reviews and inspection. We cannot say that. In which level we will find more defect? It is possible that in review, during the review and inspection, if you find more defects, then during testing, you will find less defects. Because most of the defects were found previously. So option D is also wrong. And that's why C is the answer. Let's move to the next one. How much testing is enough? First one, this answer depends on the maturity of your developers. So if developers are more skilled, then we can avoid testing. Is this the case? No. Option A is wrong. The question is impossible to answer. If you see such type of options, directly you can neglect it. The answer depends on the risk of your industry, contract, and special requirement. Yes. How it depends on the industry? Suppose you are in the avionic domain, then you have to perform regressive testing, right? And in the contract, if many things are mentioned, then you have to fulfill all those things. So based on that, you have to decide how much testing you have to do. Last option is, this question is easy to answer. So again, like option B, such options you can directly neglect. So option C is the answer over here. Next one. How does testing contribute to the software quality? How does testing contribute to the software quality? Let's see that. Testing ensures that the system under test will not error out in the production environment. I told you previously also that performing testing does not mean that in future we will not find any defects. This is what they are saying here. If you perform testing, then you are ensuring that in the production environment nothing will happen. That's not the case. B. Testing identifies defects, which ensures a successful product will be released to the market. Releasing product to the market depends upon many other factors, especially successfully releasing the product to the market, not only testing. So just because you find the defect, therefore the success will be released, the product will be released successfully, is not the case. C. Testing increases the quality of the software system by avoiding defect in the system under test. We are not avoiding the defects. When we perform testing, we find the defect. We don't avoid it. So this is not the answer. D. So D should be the answer, because none of these are answer. But let's see if why this is the answer. Testing through verification and validation of the software functionality identifies defect in the system under test. Obviously, we perform verification and validation process so that we can detect defects in the system which is under test. Therefore, option D is the answer. With this, all the quizzes are done and the topic is also complete. Now we will move to the next topic, that is, describe the relationship between testing and quality assurance. So how quality assurance and testing, or what is the relationship between testing and quality assurance, that is what we have to describe now, and that is what we will do in this lecture. Quality assurance and quality control. So before going further, or to understand this topic, what you need to know is, what is quality? It's very simple. Quality is nothing but confirmation to the requirement. So you have the so we are talking from the software testing point of view. So you have the software, or you have the requirement. In the software, we see that if it is fulfilling that requirement or not. If it fulfills that, then we say that this product is a quality product. So quality is nothing but confirmation to the requirement. Moving further, what is quality assurance? So most of the time, quality assurance is referred as QA, quality assurance. Okay, so this is one term. We have to see that how quality assurance is related, or what is the relationship between quality assurance and testing? The first and the important point is quality assurance and testing are not the same, but they are related. So this is what you need to know, that the quality assurance and testing are not the same, but they are related. How they are related? They are related by a large term called quality management. So you have a large concept called quality management that ties them together. Because of quality management, we have quality assurance and quality control or testing. Let's understand this point, how quality management ties them together. So quality management is a big term. So in the organization, they will direct you regarding the quality. They will tell what is the level of quality they want. Based on that direction, there will be a team who will develop the policies, who will develop the standards, and that is called quality assurance. To ensure the quality, they will develop the policies or standards. Now to check whether these standards or the policy, whatever they have developed, is working fine or not, we have quality control. And then in quality control, we have testing. So we perform testing activity to see that whatever we have planned or whatever is there in the policy, whether it is fulfilling or not. So that is how quality assurance and testings are related. So whatever is in the quality assurance, that we have to fulfill, or we have to check whether that is fulfilled or not by testing activities. So first you have quality management, then comes the quality assurance, quality control, that is achieved using testing. So this is the basic overview. Now let's see the definitions. Quality management is a controlled activity to direct and control an organization with regards to quality. So during quality management, what we do, we direct. We tell to the team what we need, what level of quality we require. So it is a coordinated activity which directs to achieve a certain level of quality. So a certain level of quality. Then what is quality assurance? So quality assurance is a part of quality management that focus on providing confidence that quality requirement will be fulfilled. So they will make the policies, and if we all follow that policies, then we will fulfill this requirement, the quality related requirement. Now to check whether it is fulfilled or not, we have the next stage, that is the quality control stage. Here, this is the operational technique and activity. So here we perform the actual activity. It is also the part of the quality management that are focused on fulfilling quality requirements. So we perform activity, we check that whether these requirements are fulfilled or not. So with this, we learned all the terms quality management, quality control, quality assurance and quality control. Let's see what is the difference between quality assurance and quality control. Quality assurance is a proper process. Here we define the policies. So it is a process. Whereas quality control is a test activity. Here we do activity to see that whatever is there in the policy is meeting or not. Okay, so quality assurance is a proper process, whereas quality control is the test activities. Moving further, quality assurance is a defect prevention technique. Okay, if you follow the process properly, then you can prevent the defects. Whereas as a human being, we miss, or there will be a gap between what is there in the policy and how we are working. To find that, we have a quality control. It is a defect detection mechanism. So quality assurance is a defect prevention mechanism, whereas quality control is a defect detection mechanism. So this is what you need to know. And now let's summarize all the points which we have covered till now. So the first point is quality assurance and testing are not the same. Very important point. So quality assurance and testing are not same. Quality management ties quality assurance and testing together. We have a quality management, which is a very big term, which ties quality assurance and testing together. Then we need to know about what is quality management. Quality management includes all the activities that direct and control an organization with regards to quality. Among the other activities, quality management includes both quality assurance and quality control. So quality assurance and quality control are under quality management. Then we should know what is quality assurance. Quality assurance is typically focused on adherence to proper process in order to provide confidence that appropriate level of quality will be achieved. Okay. Then comes the quality control. It involves various activities including test activity that support the achievement and appropriate level of quality. So if we perform quality control, then we can say that whether we have achieved appropriate level of quality or not. Last point, quality assurance contributes to the defect prevention. If you follow quality control, then you can prevent defects. And quality control is a defect detection mechanism. So with quality control, we detect the error. So please go through all these points. You can pause the video and you can go through the points. And then we will start with the quiz. So the first quiz is, quality control is, so what is quality control? That is what they want to know. Testing is same as quality assurance. So not at all. It is an intermediate activity. Means you are working and anytime you can start this quality control. End of phase activity. Design activity. So quality control is an end of phase activity. Why? Because once you have the output, then only you test it to see that whether it is of required quality or not. So quality control is done at the end, towards the end. That is why it is an end of phase activity. Okay, moving to the next point. Which of the following is true? Testing is same as quality assurance. Straightforward, no. Testing is not same as quality assurance. Testing is part of quality assurance. If you remember that subset graph which I have drawn, there testing was inside and it was part of the quality assurance. That's why option B is the answer. Testing is not part of the quality assurance. No, testing is same as debugging. Completely wrong. So here B is the answer. Sorry, B is the answer. Let's go to the next one. Pick the best definition of quality. So let's go through it. Quality is job done, zero defects, conformance to the requirement. Yeah, this is what in the definition we saw, right? Quality is nothing but conformation to the requirement. So straightforward, C is the answer over here. So with this, the first part of the topic is done. With the last quiz, we covered the relationship between testing and quality assurance. Now we will move to the next topic, which is very, very important. And that is distinguish between error, defect, and failure. In this topic, you need to clearly know the difference between error, defect, and failure. So they will give you one scenario. You have to read that scenario or sentence, and then you have to identify whether it is an error or it is a defect or it is a failure. So that is what we have to understand in this topic. And this topic is very, very important from the exam point of view. Definitely you will get one question from this topic. So we'll start with the definition. First, we will see the definition of error, defect, and failure. So as I said before, these three terms are very important. Error, defect, and failure. Definitely you will get one question from this topic. So the definition of error is a human action that produces an incorrect result. If a human being makes a mistake, then that is referred as an error. So being a human being, if there is a document or a code where you have made a mistake and then you find it by yourself, then it is referred as an error. Okay, now let's see the next definition, that is defect. It is a flaw in a component or system that can cause the component or system to fail to perform its required function. So here the important word is can. So the flaw is there in the component or system. Sometime you can see it, sometime you cannot see it. Okay, but it is there in the system. That is what they are saying. a flaw in a component or system that can cause the component or system to fail to perform its required function. Sometimes this flaw can make the system not to work the way it should work, and sometimes this flaw is there but nothing is happening because no one could identify that. So there could be a bug in the software, and while testing, if we are not able to find it out, and then we call it as a defect. Okay, after that comes the next term. So here what happens is you have a flaw in a system, but it is found, it is visible to the customer. That is what we will see now. It is the deviation of the component or system from its expected delivery. So the product which you have delivered to the customer, it is not working the way it should work, and the user or the customer is finding that defect. He is seeing the deviation. Okay, so such things are called failure. For an example, if you get a laptop and then the laptop hangs, whatever you press, it does not work. Then that is an example of a failure, because as a user, you are able to see this issue. So I hope all the three definitions are clear. Even if it is not clear, not a problem. We will see some examples so that you will understand what is the difference between error, defect and failure clearly. Right now, just know the definition of these three terms. First is error. It is a human action that produces an incorrect result. Okay, next. A flaw in a component or system that can cause the component or system to fail to perform its required function. Then, failure. Deviation of the component or system that is expected from its expected delivery, service or result. So, the way the component should work, it is not working that way and found by the user. Here, the term can is important, as I said. There is a flaw in a system. Sometime it can create a problem. User can find it out, and many times user may not find out also those errors. That is called the defect. Now let's understand that in more detail with the help of an explanation or example. So this is a flow of development activity which we have seen many times. Suppose we are in the user requirement stage. We received the requirement from the user. By seeing this requirement, we are writing the system requirement, and for writing this we need a system engineer. So the system engineer is writing the requirement. Now what can happen is the system engineer made mistake. Okay, this is the thing, he made a mistake. Now it is possible that, so there are two possibilities. Now he made a mistake, then he corrected that mistake by himself. This is first possibility. The other possibility is that the mistake is there and he delivered that project or product to the customer or to the next stage. So there are two possibilities. The requirement engineer made the mistake. He found the mistake by himself and he corrected it. That time we call it as an error. Now, the other scenario is that he made a mistake and he delivered that project for the next stage. Then it is called as a defect. So it is present in the work product. Now at this stage, once it is delivered, then what we will do? We will perform the review on it. If we perform review on it, and if the reviewer founds this defect, then he will provide feedback to the requirement engineer, and then the requirement engineer will correct it. So there will be no defect in the system because the reviewer found it out. But there could be a chance that the reviewer also missed this defect. So there is a flaw which is there in the system. Until now, no one has discovered it. So what will happen? Whatever requirement you are developing, it will be at that mistake, whatever is there in that, will be multiplied. So fault multiplication will happen. And then the fault will reach to the coding stage, until the coding stage. And when we are at this stage, and if we still don't find the mistake, and if the product is delivered to the customer and defect found using executing the code. So if we find the defect while executing the code, we call it as a failure. So there was a defect which is present. Then it reached to the developers or to the users. And if the user finds it out, then it is a failure. there is another scenario that defect is present but no one find it out, then it will remain as defect only. But if it is found by the customer or by the users, then it will be called as failure. I hope it is clear by now. Even if it is not clear until now, no problem, I will give you another example. But before that, let me summarize the points first. A person can make an error which is called as a mistake, okay, which can lead to the introduction of a defect. When it will lead to the introduction of a defect? If it is not corrected, if the flaw is there in the system, that time it will be referred as defect, fault or bug. All these three words are means the same: defect, fault and bug. That means you have some flaw in your system, in the software code or in some other related work product. Not only in the software but in the requirement document, as we saw in the previous example, or in the code or in the design, anywhere. So a person makes an error, that is mistake, which can lead to the introduction of defect, which is also referred as fault and bug, in the software code or in any other related work products. This is the first point. Now, an error that leads to the introduction of a defect in one work product can trigger an error that leads to the introduction of defect in a related work product. I told you that when we were in the requirement stage, if we don't find the defect, what will happen? The fault will multiply. It will go to the other stages. That is what they are saying here. A error that leads to the introduction of a defect. Defect means what? The author could not find that error, and the error is now transferred to the other stage, okay, as an output. So that is nothing but a defect in one work product. So now the work product is requirement work product, can trigger an error that leads to the introduction of defect in the related work products. What are the related work products in our example? The design document, the code, software. So those related documents it will affect. The last point: if a defect in the code is executed, then that may cause a failure. If it is not executed, then it will remain as a defect. But if the user finds it out, if the customer finds it out, then it will be referred as a failure. So now I have a last example, the second example, to explain the difference between error, defect and failure. Let's have a look into it. Suppose this is the requirement. If speed is 120 km per hour or more, then the overspeed warning shall come. So if the speed is 120 km or if it is more, then the speed warning will come. The requirement is pretty simple. But what the developer did is, he wrote this piece of code. If speed is greater than 120 km per hour, what he missed here is the equal to sign. That means even if the speed is 120, we should see this warning. That is what is missing over here. So the developer made the mistake. Now what can happen is, so this is called as a mistake, it's already done. Now the author, if he finds the mistake by himself, and then he will correct it, that time it will be referred as error only. The other scenario is that the author made the mistake but no one could find it out. If no one is able to find it out, then that will be delivered as a work product. Now it is called as a defect. So there is a flaw which is present in the system, no one found it out, so it is a defect. Then if the reviewer finds it out, then he will again tell it to the author and the author will correct it. So until here, no problem. So there was a flaw in the system, it is corrected now. But if the reviewer misses it, and then it is delivered and the code is executed and then found by the tester, user or by the customer, then it is referred as a failure. Again, I am stressing, all defects, not necessary that all defects will result in a failure, but all failures are due to the defect, because there was a flaw in a document, because of that the failure happened. But not necessary that all defects which are present in the software is visible to the user. Okay, what I want to say here is, all defects will not result in failure, but all failure, the cause of all the failures are defects. Now what I will do is, I will summarize the points. Let's see. So first we saw the definition of error. An error is defined as a human action that produces an incorrect result. It is a human action because of which we get the incorrect result. Then defect. It is a flaw in a component or system that can cause the component or system to fail. Can cause a component or system to fail to perform its required function. Failure. Failure is defined as deviation of the component or system from its expected delivery, service or result. Next three points are quite important. Fault is found by the tester in the development environment. Okay, and then whereas failure is found by the user in the operational use. Operational use means when the user is using this product, that time he is finding the mistake. So that is a failure. And it happens due to the deviation from the requirement. So what customer wants, the product is not working as per that. Fault is the cause of the failure. So this point is very, very important. Fault is the cause of the failure. With this, we will see some of the quizzes. So before that, you can go through all these points if you are not clear with it. Okay. So now let's see the first quiz. Which of the following is an example of a failure in a car cruise control system? So there is a car cruise control system. So the system is ready or available. In that we have to find what is the failure. Okay. First one, the developer of the system forgot to rename variable after a cut and paste operation. So developer was doing something like copy and paste and he forgot to rename the variable. So now this is a bug in the software, but did the customer find it out? No, not yet. This is a problem in the software, but no one found it out. So that is what is written over here. So this is not the failure. B, unnecessary code that sounds an alarm when reversing was introduced in the system, when we are doing the reverse one, but for the cruise control we are keeping the car in a constant speed. That is the functionality. So this has nothing to do with this one. So even if this code is there, it is not yet found by the user at the system level. C, the system stops maintaining a set speed when the volume, radio volume, is increased or decreased. So here what is happening? So what is cruise control? They want to keep the car at certain speed. Okay. But what is happening is when we are changing the radio volume, that is affecting the speed of the car. So clear violation of the requirement, and at the system level, that means C is the answer. Let's see the option D. The design specification of the system wrongly stated speed in kilometer per hour. Does not matter, because even if in the specification it is that way, but if no one found it out till now, not a problem. But option C, they found it out that when they change the radio button, then it is directly affecting the cruise control system. That's why option C is the answer. Let's move to the next quiz. Which of the following is an example of a failure in a car cruise control system? Here what I did is I also provided the answer. So what you can do is you can pause the video and then just go through the statements, like why it is wrong one and why this is the right one. I already explained it. So we will move to the next one. Which one of the statement below describes the most common situation for a failure? Most common situation for a failure discovered during testing or in production. So when you are doing testing or when you are in production mode, which of the following situation will cause a failure? First one, the product crashed when the user selected an option in a dialog box. So there is a dialog box, user tried to enter something and the product crashed. Looks like this is the answer, but we have to also go through all the options. B, the wrong version of a compiled source code file was introduced in the build. So wrong version of the source code was used, but that is not causing any problem and or not yet found. So this is not the answer. C, the computation algorithm used the wrong input variable. Might be we are using the wrong input variable, but that is also not causing any problem. So that is, there is a flaw in the system, but no one has found it out. So this is also not the failure. The developer misinterprets the requirement for the algorithm. It's fine, they have misinterpreted it, but still no one has found this mistake. So what, where the mistake is, the product crashed when the user selected an option in the dialog box. So this is what user has experienced. So this is going to be the answer. Option A is the answer over here. The same thing again, I explained all the points, why the first one is wrong, why the other points are right. You can go through it, you can pause the video and go through it. I will move to the next one. Below is a list of problems that can be observed during testing or in production. Which one of these problems is a failure? I think this is a same question asked again and again in the exam. Only thing is they have just changed certain points here. That's it. In the B, C and D, they have little bit changed, but the answer is still same. The product crashed when the user selected option in a dialog box. They have just made this false version highlighted like that. But in the previous one, it was not like that. Okay. So, yeah. Again, the explanation is provided over here. But we can move to the next one. Yeah. Which of the following is a correct statement? This is also very important. It was asked in the exam, this particular question. A developer makes a mistake which causes a defect. So when developer makes a mistake that causes a defect, okay, that may be seen as a failure during dynamic testing. Okay, so we will see whether this is the answer or not, or which one is the appropriate answer. A developer makes an error, okay, which results in a failure that may be seen as a fault when the software is executed. Completely wrong, right? First is error, then fault should come, and then failure will be observed. Failure will be seen, not fault is seen. Because of that, this option B is wrong. A developer has introduced a failure which results in a defect that may be seen as a mistake during dynamic testing. So this here they have completely reversed the order. First, they are telling that the failure is there because of the defect is there, and finally they are telling there is a, that was a mistake. So this is also wrong. A developer makes a mistake which causes a bug that may be seen as a defect when the software is executed. When we execute the software, we don't see defect, we saw failure. That's why option A is the answer. A developer makes a mistake which causes a defect that may be seen as a failure during dynamic testing. Option A is the answer. So you can go through the solution again by pausing the video. What I am doing is I am going with the next one. Which of the following is the correct statement? Okay. An error causes a failure which results in a defect. So if there is an error that causes a failure which results in a defect. So the order is wrong here. A defect causes a failure which results in an error. So at the end they are saying it is an error. So this is wrong. A failure is observed as an error and the root cause is the defect. This is also not right, I think. A error causes a defect which is observed as a failure. This is right. Because of error, you will have a defect, and that will be when it is observed by someone else, then it is called as a failure. So D is the answer over here. Next one. Again, the solution is here. You can read it. A failure is, if you see that, they are very much interested in failure. So you should know how to differentiate failure from error and defect. Most of the time, even I have seen, the question comes from the failure part. Found in the software, the result of an error. So failure is found in the software, result of an error. Let's see. Departure from specific behavior. This is important. Deviation from specific behavior, that is the word we saw. Departure from specific behavior is also the same, that it is not meeting the specific behavior. B is the answer. C, an incorrect step, process or data definition in the computer program. No, a human action that produces an incorrect result. This is an error. So B is the answer over here. Again, what is failure? So here they have written clearly, deviation from expected result to the actual result. Okay, so here it looks quite clear that option A is the answer. B is defect in the software. Defect can result in failure and may not result in failure also, may or may not. Error in the program code, no. Fault in the system is the same. Fault and defect both are the same. So with this, we have last question over here. Which of the following could be reason of a failure? Testing fault? Yes, if you make any fault in the testing, if you are not finding the bug, then the customer can find that bug. Yes. Software fault? Obviously, if there is a fault in the software, then there is a possibility that it may result in a failure. Similarly, the design fault, the environment related fault, or any documentation related fault. That means any fault, as I said, could become the reason for the failure. If you see all the options, option D, there we are saying all of them are valid reason for failure. Okay, so with this, we should know what is the difference between error, defect, and failure. Now, what are we going to see is the causes of failure or error, defect, and failure. Like, what are the different causes that can result in an error, defect, or failure in a software? So there are two causes or the broad terms which are used in the STQ syllabus. That is, one is the normal causes of defect and the environmental causes of defect. Normal causes means when you are working, because of the working culture or the environment, because of that the bug will be introduced into the system. Environmental causes means because of the environment in which the product is going to be used. So when we say normal defect causes, so this is the list which is provided over here. Time pressure, human fallibility. As a human being, we can make mistake, as I said. Inexperienced and insufficiently skilled people. Miscommunication and misunderstanding. Complexity of the code. Unfamiliar technologies. So these are few lists which they have provided. What we will do is we will go through them one by one. First one is time pressure. So if you are working in an environment where you are given very little time to complete your task, then it is possible that you will overlook certain things that may cause a defect, because there is a time pressure. Definitely you will try to finish your work as early as possible, and that during that time you may overlook certain things. Yeah, so this is one thing, the normal causes, the time pressure. Next one, human fallibility. As a human, we all are fallible, means we can make mistake, because fallible means likely to make error or failures. Nobody is perfect after all. Okay, so this is human fallibility. Next one, inexperienced and insufficiently skilled people. So if you are working in an organization where there are people without sufficient knowledge or required skill set for the project, then it may result in a defect. If the people are not skilled enough, then that may result in a defect because they don't understand the system completely. Next one, miscommunication or misunderstanding. If you don't have a proper channel of communication, that will also introduce error in your system. If your organization or team lacks proper channel of communication, this could lead to the defect. If you're only discussing over phone, then there are some words or there are some numbers which you can misunderstand, and that will result in a cause defect. Next one, complexity of the code. So even if you are experienced, skilled person, if the code is complex, then you might end up making an error. So even if the team is quite experienced, but the code itself is very, very complex, then that may result in a defect. Unfamiliar technology. Similar to that, even if you are very much experienced, first of all, since it is a new technology, you are not experienced on this technology, but you have a past experience on working on similar technologies. If you are working with a technology that you don't know enough about, then this can also result in a defect. Next one, this is a new cause which is introduced in the latest syllabus, which I have included here. It is included in It is included for 2001 exam, that is intra system and inter system. So what it means is, if you are working on a small part of a big system, then there is a possibility that you might not know the intended use of the system, which may result in interface related issues. If you don't know where your system is going to be used, you are working on a very small part of the system, and then you don't know that who all are going to access your system, what are the interfaces, what are the outside interfaces, how they are going to take the data from your system. If you don't know all these things, that means if you don't know about the intra system and the inter system, then also it may result in an error. So these were few of the normal causes. Now we will have a look into the environmental causes. The first cause is the radiation. If there is unintended radiation to which your product is exposed, that then it may fail to perform what it should perform. Electromagnetic fields. So you also know that when we take a flight, in that they asked us to turn off our electronic devices, especially the mobile phone or tablets, so that we don't have a electromagnetic interference with the flight. Otherwise it may result in some failure. Next one is related to the pollution. For example, you have a sensor which should sense something, and then because of pollution there is a dust particle over there, and then it is not sensing properly, then that may cause a error. Likewise, there could be many other environmental issues like humidity or many other like, but what you need to remember is radiation, electromagnetic field and pollution are the environmental cause of defect. Now let's summarize all the defects again. So we saw two causes of defect. First one is the normal cause of defect, and next one is the environmental cause of defect. Seven normal causes of defect are time pressure, human fallibility, inexperienced and insufficiently skilled people, miscommunication or misunderstanding within the team or team member, complexity of the code, unfamiliar technologies, misunderstanding about inter-system and intra-system interfaces, especially when such inter-system or intra-system interactions are large in number. If it is a very big system, then this problem will occur. And three, environmental causes of defect, that is radiation, electromagnetic field, pollution. Now with that, what we covered is third topic, distinguish between error, defect and failure. As I said, I'm repeating it again, this is a very important topic, especially the meaning of error, defect and failure. Now moving to the next topic, that is distinguish between the root cause of a defect and its effect. So now we need to know what is the meaning of root cause and what is the meaning of effect, impact or effect. Okay, so this is the two things we need to understand. We have to understand the difference between them, when we can say this is the root cause and when we can say this is an effect of that defect. We will understand this topic now with the help of an example. So as I said, this is the last topic of last subtopic of this main topic, that is what is testing. So first of all, to understand this topic, you need to know what is the meaning of root cause. What is root cause? It's pretty simple. It is the earliest action or conditions that contributed to creating the defect. Very first condition because of which the error is happening or because of which the system is failing. The very first condition is referred as root cause. The source of the problem, the first source of the problem is called root cause. It is the earliest action or conditions that contributed to creating the defect. Okay, earliest action and condition. This is what you have to understand. Earliest action and condition. Now what we will do is, I will have two examples. So with the help of first example, I will try to explain what is the meaning of root cause analysis. Okay, suppose this is the requirement given. Once the speed is more than 115, red light shall glow. So when the speed is more than 115, which is over here, when it crosses that, so this is a speedometer, and for this speedometer we have a requirement. When the speed crosses 115, then the red light shall glow. But when we deliver this speedometer to the customer, customer is unhappy. Now the question is, we should ask why customer is unhappy? Because customer made an observation. What customer is saying is, when he set or when they set the speed to 116, so this is 115, they set the speed to 116. Expected is that the red light shall be on, but the red light is not on, it is off. That is what the customer is seeing. He is not seeing the warning. Red light is not glowing. Okay, so this is the observation made by the customer. Now we have to find out why customer found this observation or why customer made this observation. For that, when we analyzed, we saw that the in the coding, what we did is, if speed is greater than and equal to 150, instead of 15, we wrote 150. So this is the problem. Then we have to analyze why we did that, why we code like that. Then when we investigated, what we saw is, due to the requirement, we wrote like this. In the requirement, they are saying, red light shall glow when speed is more than 150. So this is unexpectable, unacceptable. Why in the requirement it is made like this? Now, there are many reasons why we have written it like this. But one of the reason I have picked here, that miscommunication. We said, like, if there is a miscommunication, that may result in an error. So this is the example. Because of the miscommunication, this error had happened. Why miscommunication? Because previously to discuss, they were talking over the phone. So in the phone, they were talking, and then based on that, someone said 115, that is 115, but the person heard 150 and they wrote it like this. So with this, what we understood is, the customer is unhappy is an effect. This is the final outcome. So final outcome is referred as an effect. Then this is the observation which is made by the customer. So this is a failure because the customer or the user observed this one. Now, why is this failure? Because something is wrong here in these two documents. So this is the document, this is the code. Both are referred as defect. Why we have this defect? Because of this miscommunication. So miscommunication is the first source because of which this error happened. So that's why this is a root cause. This is the first action or condition because of which we have a failure. But we will not stop over here. We have to see that it is we are not repeating this mistake again. So we have to take action. And in the action, we will say that now from here onwards, any discussion regarding the requirement will happen through email, via email. So if we don't get email, then we will not write the requirement for that particular feature. So that way, what we are doing is, we are avoiding the future mistake. So this is one of the advantage of root cause. If we know why the problem occurred, then we can solve it and we can avoid the future mistakes also. Now, I have another example to understand the same topic. Here, again, it will start with a customer complaint. So as we know, customer complaint is nothing but the effect. So outcome is the effect. Next, why customer is complaining? Because customer, when doing the calculation, what this saw is incorrect interest payment calculation. When they were calculating the interest, they saw that it is the product or the calculator is not calculating it properly. So this is the observation made by the customer. That's why it is a failure. So now we have to find out the reason for that. The reason is single line of incorrect code. This is a defect because this is a flaw which is present in the system. No one found it out. So this is a defect right now. Now the question is why the single line of code is wrong. So for that, because the defective code was written, and the root cause is due to the product owner's misunderstanding of how to calculate the interest. So product owner was not aware how to calculate the interest, but he wrote some formula and then that formula was not working and the customer found it out. Now the question is, we have an entire team and then how come one person is not knowing this? So we have to address this issue. For that, what we will do is, we will take an action. We will train the product owner and the respective team members so that they know how to calculate the interest. So this is what we have to do, and you can see that the output is the effect, whereas the root cause is the first action or condition because of which that happened, this failure happened. I hope it is clear now what is the root cause. This is the first action because of which the error is happening. Failure and effect is the comes at the later stage because of the defect or because of the first condition. This is clear. What I will do is, or what we need to know is, why we should perform root cause analysis. Why we need to do a root cause analysis? It is pretty simple, as we discussed, to prevent significant number of future defects from being introduced. We want to avoid the future defects. So if we have the root cause, then we can fix the issue for future. Next one is to reduce the occurrence of similar defect in future. If the customer will find same defects again and again, then they will also get irritated. So we have to know the root cause so that they don't see this problem in future. So we want to reduce the occurrence of similar defects in future. Third one, to improve the process. So when we find the defect, then we see that, okay, which is the area, what is where we make mistake, and then we can provide some improvement points for that, or we can define some process. So 3 points why we need the root cause analysis as per ISTQB: to prevent significant number of future defect from being introduced, futuristic, to reduce the similar defects in future, new defects we want to prevent, similar defect we want to prevent, and we want to improve our process. Now let's summarize the point which we saw till now. So first we saw what is root cause. Root cause is the earliest action or condition that contributed to the creating of defect. So first action because of which we get the defect. What is the need of root cause analysis? To prevent a significant number of future defects from being introduced, we want to make sure that new defect won't crop up in the future. To reduce the occurrence of similar defect in future, to improve the process. So this is quite clear now. If not, please go through it by pausing the video, because we are going to solve one quiz based on this topic. So here is the quiz. You can see that this is called as a scenario based question or as an application based question, where they will give you a scenario. You have to read it, and based on your understanding, you have to select the right option. Okay, so now let's go through the question. A new retail product was released to the production by the company. So there is some product which is released to the company by the company. Shortly after the release, it was apparent that there was numerous problem with the point of sale application. So once they made the sale application, sold it, then there are a lot of issue they are getting it. This resulted in a number of customer complaints and negative posting on the social media, which is encouraging the people to take their business to the competitors. Okay, so now because of there are some mistakes, so negative campaigning is happening in the social media, and because of which the competitor may get advantage over this product. You have investigated the problem and have discovered that the production point of sale equipment is a later model. So this is a new model which we have. Then the model used in the testing. So in the testing we use the old model, but in the production we use the latest model. The software functions correctly in the old version but fails on the later model. So what they are telling is, the old model in which we are doing the testing, everything is working fine in that, but we also had a latest model which we didn't use here. But when we check this software or the product with the latest tool or with the latest software, then we are finding the mistake. So given this scenario, what is the root cause and what is the effect? So you need to know what is the first condition because of which the error happened, and what was its effect. So first option is, the root cause is the old equipment and the effect is the new equipment. So effect is not the new equipment, right? What is the effect? Effect is that social campaigning which is happening, the negative feedback, that is the impact. So that is not mentioned here. That is the effect. That is not mentioned here. So that is wrong. The root cause is the customer complaints and the effect is the social media posting. So root cause is not the customer complaint, right? Customer will complain once he gets the, or they get the wrong product. So that is the impact, that is the effect, not the root cause. B is not the answer. C, The root cause is conducting the testing on the wrong software version of the equipment, and the effect is the customer complaint and posting. Yes, the root cause, if we would have used the latest version of the software, we could have found this during our testing, but we didn't do that. By mistake we chose the wrong wrong version, because of which that bug is introduced now, or we could not found that bug. D, the root cause is the software failing on the later model. No, software is failing on the later model, that is correct, it should fail. So that is not the root cause. The root cause is that during testing we didn't use the correct software or correct version of the software. And the effect is customer complaint. Yes, effect is customer complaint, but as we saw, the answer is C. The root cause is conducting the testing on the wrong version of the equipment, and the effect is the customer complaint and posting. I hope this question is now clear and how you have to analyze it. This is what I have written here. There is the answer. You can read it by pausing the video. And with this quiz, what we did is we covered the first two main topics of the first chapter. That is, what is testing and why is testing necessary. And in this, I told you there are the important topics are the objective of testing, debugging, and then error, defect, and failure, and as well as the root cause and the effect. So these are the four topics out of which definitely you will get three questions. So in this chapter, you will get approximately 8 to 9 questions, and three questions you will definitely get from these four topics. With this, I end this lecture over here. Thank you.